Hello again, everybody. Welcome to Two Ends of the Scale, the podcast where Sam and I talk about music. Sam, would you care to introduce yourself?
I'm Sam. I'm a classically trained musician, and I know nothing about popular music.
So he says, although maybe he does know a little bit. My name is Alan, and I'm self-taught, and I know nothing about classical. We had some comments on episode 2.
Oh, yes.
Thank you to the people who commented on episode 2. We are going to address some of those comments, aren't we?
Yeah, so actually I've got 2 follow-up things.
Did you want to save them to the end, though?
There's one that I will save for the end. I was already planning to mention it.
Well, there's a cliffhanger. Stay tuned to the end of the podcast to hear what Sam has to say about a comment. But Sam, there's another comment that you would like to comment on now.
Well, there's one thing that I forgot to mention last time when we were talking about meter and the meter of text and the meter of music.
Go on.
And I just thought you might want to hear it. Someone called Jay Foreman has an excellent example of what it sounds like when the meter of your text doesn't line up with the meter of your music.
Oh, yeah. I'd like to hear that.
Yeah, I'll play it for you. We'll include a link as well.
So this is an example of kind of doing it wrong or doing it badly.
Yes. So he takes well-known songs and then shifts the line to be one syllable later. So all of the stresses are in the wrong place.
Okay. That's going to sound horrible, isn't it?
Yeah, it's weird.
Des Desmond has a trolley in the market. Place Molly is a singer in the band. Desmond says to Molly, girl, I like your face. And in the evening, she's a singer with the band. Oh, blah.
Wow. That's incredible that he can do that just on the fly.
They were all Beatles songs, so I guess he's practiced the entire corpus of Beatles songs, but...
Oh, yeah. And it's
at
just
least once.
And hoping that the audience call out something sort of well-known and... Wow.
Obla-di obla-da is a really difficult one, because I tried it. I could do it with quite a lot of Beatles songs, because fortunately Beatles songs are about the only pop songs I do know. But I couldn't do it with that one, because it's really hard.
Yeah. I wonder how he does it. Do you think he writes it out so he can see it on the page?
I don't know. That's a good question.
We could turn it into a game for our episode on musical games that we're going to play at some point. Oh, thank you for that example, Sam, of having the stress in the wrong place and... Yeah, it just sounds terrible, but funny. Like, it's cool. Of course, last time in episode 2, we talked about rhythm. This time, we're going to talk about polyrhythm.
Yeah, we had so much to say about rhythm that... basically, I would have kept you here for hours last time if we didn't split it up.
Just to explain the format, Sam has chosen 3 pieces of music.
You say that in a questioning tone because... I've got 3 pairs of pieces.
Oh, so but, 6. 6 pieces of music.
But I don't know if we'll do both of all of them. I'll see how I feel.
Okay. I have just a list of songs with interesting things about polyrhythm, and I haven't decided yet which ones I'm going to play you.
Okay, so we're both in the same position then.
That's good. Except you've actually planned what you're going to play for me, whereas I'm just going to do it on the spur of the moment. So who's going to go first?
I went first last time, so do you want to go first?
Yes, I do. Mm. Now, Sam, as I get to go first this week and play my song to you, I also get to ask you some questions. So my first question is, Sam, what is polyrhythm?
I should have seen this coming and written down a definition beforehand. It's when you have 2 or more parts subdividing a beat or bar into different proportions that, in general, that can't be expressed as a ratio of n to 1.
Nice. I like how you got the mathematics in there, the ratio of n to 1.
Well, otherwise the definition would include one part subdividing a beat into 2 and another into 4, and we generally consider that to be the same.
Absolutely. I feel like even before we play any of the songs, we should do an example now of what you just said there about having 4 and 2, because I think you're right that no musician would describe 4 against 2 as a polyrhythm. Should we just perform that now?
Okay, then.
I'll do the 4, you do the 2.
Okay.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's not exciting, is it? I'll play you the first song, Sam. This is by a band called The Music, which in my opinion is the reason that they never made it big. Because if your band is called The Music and you try Googling the Music, you're never going to find them. Okay. The song is called Freedom Fighters by The Music. Sam has just pulled out a pen and is writing down.
Yeah, I'm good at my brain's not in gear today, so I'm going to make it easier for myself and possibly write it down. So I'm not sure what you're getting at there.
Okay. Yeah. Do you think you could sing the guitar riff?
Yep.
Go on. Okay. I don't think it does do that,
no.
Actually.
Actually, I'm not sure what it does after that first
I
bit.
Think it goes...
Oh, yeah, it does. Oh, yeah, I didn't pick up on that, actually.
Yeah, it's really subtle, isn't it?
Mm.
So could you explain just what's happening there?
So, for the most part, it's shuffled? I'm not sure, swung or shuffled?
I don't know if there even is a difference between swung and shuffled. But, yeah, the drums are certainly doing the...
And then for a little bit, the... guitar plays straight eighth notes.
It does. And it took me a long time to hear that in it. And then when we kept on playing it just now, because you hadn't detected it straight away, I started to doubt myself. I was like, maybe the guitar is following the drums exactly in terms of the rhythm. But it doesn't. It doesn't, does it?
No, you are absolutely right.
So mathematically, Sam, could you just explain what shuffle is or swing, and then how that is a polyrhythm with the guitar?
Okay, so the drums and the guitar for the first half of that riff are subdividing the quarter note beat into 3, and they play on the first and third of those beats. And then for the second half of that guitar riff, the guitar then subdivides the beat into 2 notes of equal length against the drums' shuffle rhythm.
Okay. I'm just going to play the part of my housemate from university who once said to me, but hang on, why can't... You said that the drums are subdividing the beat into 3 sub-beats... And you said as well that the drums are playing beat 1 and beat 3 of that subdivision. So the drums are just playing 2 beats. And then you just said that the guitar plays 2 beats as well. So what's odd about that?
So it's their placement in time. If you draw a graph, let's say, for the sake of simplicity, a
Can we
beat...
do a cake instead?
A cake?
Yeah, imagine not a round cake. Don't make it a round cake. Imagine a Swiss roll, like a long cake.
Okay.
Swiss roll. And you've got 2 Swiss rolls. Explain to me with Swiss rolls.
Okay, then. So in Swiss rolls, the second half of the guitar riff, he's splitting the Swiss roll directly in half So there's two pieces, and if you measure them, they're the same length as each other.
They are.
And then the rest of the time, he's splitting up his Swiss roll by cutting it a third of the way along, so that one piece is twice as long as the other piece.
There we go.
From now on, I think all of our polyrhythms should now be described in terms of Swiss rolls.
I thought I'd introduce that now, the Swiss, because I think that's how I ended up explaining it to him with a Swiss roll. Okay, but I like that example because it took me a long time to spot it as a polyrhythm.
Yes, it's subtle.
It's subtle. And you were primed. You knew you were listening for a polyrhythm.
Yeah.
And it passed you by.
I'll blame the fact that I've got a cold and I can't hear out of one ear.
Okay.
That's my excuse.
You should turn around, Sam, so that your good ear is facing the speaker.
But then I'll be facing away from the microphone.
Ah. Sam, I think it's time for your first pair of pieces.
Yeah. So, I have taken some liberties with what this episode's about, a little bit, maybe. So it's polyrhythm and polymeter. So Mozart's Don Giovanni from the end of Act 1. It's a ballroom scene.
Okay, I think I know what's happening there. You had one and two and three and one and two and three, then da. So in a way it's the same as mine.
So yeah, that's the simplest possible polyrhythm by our earlier definition, would you say?
Yes.
You got half of it.
Okay, but there's another element that I missed.
Do you want to have another listen?
Yes, and maybe if you focus me in, because I think we listened to about 2 minutes of music there.
Yeah, just about.
Let's have another listen. I don't think I'm going to be able to get it.
It is hard to spot sometimes if you're not aware of what's going on.
Mm-hmm. What's going on?
So what Mozart has here is he's got three orchestras on stage and the characters are dancing three different dances.
Wow.
So we start off with a minuet in 3-4, and it's all perfectly normal. And then the second orchestra comes in with a contradance in 2-4.
Oh.
But the crotchet beat is still the same.
Wow.
So the bar lines are then in different places.
Gotcha. So if we just go into Swiss roll terminology here, let's say that the first orchestra have got two Swiss rolls end to end, and each Swiss roll represents a bar, and each Swiss roll has been cut into three bits. So we've got six little pieces of Swiss roll altogether.
Mm-hmm.
And then the second orchestra comes in, and they have got Swiss rolls which are shorter. They've got Swiss rolls which are two-thirds the length of the other Swiss rolls, and they've got three of them, and they're going to cut theirs in half.
Yes, that is correct. So we've got one orchestra has two Swiss rolls cut into thirds.
Yeah.
The other orchestra has three Swiss rolls, each cut in half, and all of the pieces are the same size.
Yeah. So to make that work mathematically, you need the Swiss rolls belonging to the second orchestra to be shorter than the Swiss rolls. Yeah, fantastic. Now, you said that Mozart has got three orchestras on the stage.
So when the third orchestra started their German dance, you did notice that one. They have a German dance in 3/8.
Right. So in Swiss rolls...
It's a little bit more complicated because they have it in 3/8, but their dotted crotchet is the same length as the crotchet of the other two orchestras.
In Swiss rolls, please.
Okay, so in Swiss rolls, so the third orchestra has six Swiss rolls to line up with the second orchestra's three and the first orchestra's two.
Yes.
And then each of those Swiss rolls
is cut into thirds. Gotcha, yeah. Wow, this is mathematics at work, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
That's a wonderful example. So I think what's going on here is the third orchestra are doing a polyrhythm with respect to the first and the second orchestra. But the first and the second orchestra, you wouldn't describe that as a polyrhythm. What would you describe that as?
Well, I would say it's a polymeter.
Polymeter.
So they've got different meters, but they're not subdividing the beats differently.
So Mozart's got this, it sounds incredible, like three orchestras on stage, three different dances happening simultaneously. What's going on in the story?
I don't know it very well. Let me have a think. In one of the dances, there's one character trying to distract another character. In the second dance, Don Giovanni is trying to seduce a woman and eventually leads her off stage and tries to assault her. Oh yeah, I can't remember, but I think the third dance is other characters who have a grudge against Don Giovanni have entered. They're just kind of hanging around until they confront him at the end of that section. I think that's... my memory is not perfect, and I don't actually know very much about the opera, so I think that's what's happening.
I just wondered, why... I mean, it sounds like a very clever thing for Mozart to have done, to have these not exactly three different rhythms, but there's polyrhythm and there's a polymeter there. So why... why do you think he chose that?
There are these three dances in different meters, just different kinds of dance, and each of these dances is assigned to characters by their social status and the social status of that dance.
Right.
So that's one.
So it separates them.
Yes. Yeah.
But with the music, nice. You said you had a second example.
Yeah, so that polymeter is the simplest example. It's a 2-3. But have a quick listen. I won't talk about this one much, but have a quick listen. This is a Passacaglia from Benjamin Britten's Peter Grimes.
That's cool. Yeah, I'd have to listen to that a lot to just work out when each part starts and how long it lasts.
It's hard to hear. I would recommend listening to the whole thing though, because it's a really lovely piece of music.
Mm.
So what's happening there is there's a ground bass, so the bass is just repeating the same thing over and over again.
Boom, boom.
Which is it's repeating this 11 beat phrase, over and over again. And then over the top of that, all the other parts have changing meters.
Wow. And so is it fair to say that in a polymeter, everyone is playing at the same tempo?
Yes.
Well, thank you, Sam, for those two pieces of polymeter. I think I feigned ignorance there when you talked about polymeter, because I did sneakily know what polymeter was.
Ah, I see.
Because my next example has got polymeter.
It's almost like we planned this.
I don't think any discussion of polyrhythm or polymeter could go without mention of Meshuggah. Have you heard of Meshuggah?
Is that a person or a group?
It's a group. They're a Swedish extreme metal band. They do lots of silly things with time. So we're going to listen to Do Not Look Down. And you just need to do a little bit of counting. Are you ready?
Okay, I'm ready. Can we listen to the beginning of it again?
Yeah. The beginning, I think, is where it's clearest.
Okay, I'm not entirely sure, but is it alternating between 8 and 11?
I'm not certain either, but I don't think so.
Okay, I'm not sure then.
Okay.
So, please tell me what's going on.
So sometimes I think Meshuggah are, like, labelled as the polyrhythm band, but their drummer, a chap called Thomas Hake, he says, no, we never do polyrhythm. What he does as a drummer is always to just hit quarter notes, crotchets. I've learned something on a cymbal and an accent 2 and 4 on the snare. But it's what he does with his feet to play the bass drum and what the guitarists are doing, which get people all excited, because it's like, oh, this doesn't sound like normal metal music. Because what the guitars are doing is often playing a polymeter, not 4-4, but I think in that song it's 17-16. Shall I count the way that I count it?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 like about that is the drummer is, I mean, maybe you wouldn't describe that as accenting 2 and 4. I think he's hitting the snare on beat 3, so it has like a halftime feel. And that's pretty much throughout the whole song, that he just keeps that steady.
Yeah, it's interesting.
They definitely kind of carved out their own niche in the heavy metal world by doing that. I guess fairly recently, like in the last 10 years, lots of other metal bands have heard this sound and thought, wow, what is that? What are they doing? And we want to copy it. And so now there are loads and loads of heavy metal bands that use that kind of technique. Just, oh, let's write a riff in, you know, 23/16 and just play that underneath a steady 4/4 groove.
Mm. So do you want to attempt to put this one into Swiss roll terms? Because it's a lot more complicated than any of the ones we've talked about so far.
Yeah, I guess imagine a normal Swiss roll cut into 4 equal pieces, cut into quarters. And then you've got another Swiss roll, which you're going to cut into 16 equal pieces. And then somehow you create another 16th of a Swiss roll. Let's start again. Okay, Sam, to explain it with Swiss rolls, we're going to need 3 Swiss rolls. but one of them is going to be almost completely wasted. So the first Swiss roll, we cut that into quarters, so they're really big pieces. The kind of piece that you would want, Sam, is a giant slab of Swiss roll. And then the other Swiss roll is cut into much more modest pieces. You're going to slice that into 16 little pieces. And then for this third Swiss roll, most of which is going to get wasted, we cut off 1/16 and then throw the rest away. And now we're going to do some lining up. So we've got our Swiss roll that we cut into four, and that goes on the table. And then next to it, we put the 16/16, and then we add on that extra little bit of Swiss roll on the end. And that's our 17/16. Then what you do is just duplicate that loads and loads of times so that you have all your quarter Swiss rolls in a massive long line along the top, and below it, you have all your 17/16. And after a lot of Swiss roll pieces, you'll eventually get back to the start and the pattern will repeat.
Presumably it would be after 16 lots of that.
16 lots of the...
of the...
16th note Swiss roll. And
yes.
17 lots of
yes.
the... Yes, that's right.
What you really need are pictures of these Swiss rolls.
You know what? That's what we should do, is we will include pictures of the Swiss rolls. Sam, are you happy to make pictures?
Yeah, I will draw some Swiss rolls and put them... I'll put them somewhere and put a link to it in the description.
Fantastic. Just before we move on to your second pair of pieces, how did you feel as you were listening to that Meshuggah song? Like, what was your response to it emotionally?
I don't know, I quite enjoyed it.
What did you enjoy?
I enjoyed the kind of liveliness that the irregular meter gave it.
Yeah, yeah, me too. I don't know, I find it more enjoyable to listen to that than some other heavy metal, just because it's so odd and crazy.
Yeah, yeah, I really enjoyed listening to that. When the singer came in, I started enjoying it less.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I think that style of metal vocal is definitely an acquired taste.
Yeah, it's... and I'm not knocking that style. It's just not... It's not something that I personally like.
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean, because I used to feel very similar. Like, it just completely turned me off. We were talking the other day, weren't we, about acquired taste and what it meant. Do you remember? Like,
Yes.
Because I had always thought an acquired taste meant like a specialist taste or like a niche interest if you had an acquired taste in something. But in a way, that's not what it means, is it?
No, I mean, it's kind of literal. It's something that you, in a way, learn to appreciate.
Yeah, you acquire it after work or repeated exposure.
Yeah.
And then you have a taste for it. And I think with that style of heavy metal vocal, I had to kind of work at liking it, and it seems odd to do that. Like, why would you listen to something that you're not really enjoying? When I was a teenager, my parents didn't have the internet, so I didn't have access to websites like Napster, where you can just listen to whatever music you want. You had to, you know, go out and buy music. And so if someone recommended a band to me, I'd go and spend money, like, buying the CD. And CDs, you know, they're not cheap. So I bought an album by Funeral for a Friend, because everyone was really into Funeral for a Friend. And I spent, like, £10 on it. And I hated it. Like, I really, really didn't like it at all. And I think if you heard the first track on that album, you'd know why. Because, like, they just start, like, full on. And it's the only CD that I've ever had where I thought, I'm going to take this back to the shop because I really don't like this. But yeah, I had loads of friends who were like, no, they're such a great band. And so I listened to it, and I listened to it, and listened to it. And then eventually, I grew to really, really like it.
Yeah, that's interesting. I don't have quite the same experience, because the internet has been available to me for more of my life. But studying music, there have been things that I've had to listen to quite a few times that I really didn't enjoy. And some of them I grew to like, some of them I still am not a fan of.
Oh, I feel like this is a whole other episode, but what were the ones that you did start to enjoy?
This is absolutely going to be a whole other episode. But I guess atonal music.
Oh, right. So atonal music, you didn't enjoy it, but then after listening to it, you did start to get something out of it?
Well, because obviously there's lots of types of atonal music.
Okay.
So certain genres of atonal music I came to appreciate a lot more.
Do you think it was worth it?
I feel like we're delving too much into this. This needs to be a separate episode.
Sam, I believe it is your turn to play two bits of music to me.
Yeah, so...
Wait, when did this two bits of music thing become a thing?
I think you started it.
Oh, no, I did,
didn't Back in episode one.
Oh, you're right. Oh, never mind. Move on quickly. But,
well, what I did was, I thought that the obvious examples for all of the polyrhythm are from the 20th century.
Okay.
Because that's when composers started being really wacky and doing weird things. But I didn't want to just do 20th century stuff. So I've gone back and found earlier examples of all the things.
Oh, brilliant.
We've just been talking about arrangements that are... arrangements of beats that are different in length and so get out of sync.
Yeah.
So I'm going to play you some music that's isorhythmic now. Then we'll have a talk about it. The first movement from the Quartet for the End of Time by Olivier Messiaen.
After work, and that music was just playing in your house, and no one else was at home, what would you think?
I would probably think that I was losing my mind.
Didn't you say that the 20th century was when composers went wacky?
Yes.
That's not from the 20th century?
Oh, yeah, that one is.
Oh, that one is. Oh, I was thinking, that sounds very modern. Like, whoa, that is quite creepy. Are you happy with that word, creepy, or do you have a different...
No, I am absolutely happy with that. So this is called the Quartet for the End of Time.
Yeah.
And Messiaen wrote it while he was a prisoner of war.
Right.
And I think he wrote it for... the four instruments that were available. They were the only four instruments they had.
So there was a piano, was it a clarinet?
Mm-hmm.
And a violin?
Yeah, and a cello.
Yeah, that's weird. Now, I was thinking about, like, just listening to music. This is another podcast episode. Listening to music and how you listen to music. Because, like, I wanted to just listen to it without trying to... dissect it,
yeah,
and get that kind of emotional response from it. But because it was starting to weird me out a bit, I thought I'll concentrate on the rhythm, and that's not gonna creep me out so much. It's like when you're watching a horror film and you're thinking, I'm a little bit disturbed by this, I'm just gonna concentrate on the cinematography. Have you ever done that?
I don't think so, but I don't really watch horror films, no. So...
I don't really watch horror films either. But... So, isorhythm. That confused me, because iso means equal, doesn't it?
Equal or the same.
The same. So one thing that I think I detected was that the clarinet and the piano seemed to be sort of filling in the gaps. So the piano was kind of filling in gaps between the clarinet. Maybe? No. Your pause says no. You're looking at sheet music.
I am.
Thinking.
No, I can't really see that.
No, okay.
It's... the clarinet just has more kind of static moments.
I mean, based on, as you've just said, iso means the same. So I'm just going to guess here, because I don't think I could hear this at all. Is everybody playing the same rhythm, but just starting at a different time?
No.
Oh. So is that, okay, I mean, that's wrong, but you can see why I guessed that?
Yeah, I can.
But it's not right.
That would make sense, but that's not why it's called isorhythm.
Go on. Why is it called isorhythm?
So the piano and the cello parts each have a pattern of rhythmic values, and they're just repeating that rhythm again and again and again. So the piano has 17 note values that it plays. It lasts for 13 beats, and it just plays that rhythm again and again and again and again.
Oh, okay, right. So those numbers, straight away, are setting off alarm bells in my head, because you say 17 beats.
17. So there's 17 notes, 17 rhythmic values that in total last for 13 beats.
Okay, because 13 is a prime number.
Mm-hmm.
That's not going to make for happy... lowest common multiples, is it?
No, it is not. So the cello has 15 rhythmic values lasting for 16 and a half beats.
16 and a half. That's not even prime. That's okay, yeah.
So I haven't mentioned the other key thing, though, is that they also have a series of pitches that they're repeating again and again and again.
Right.
Which are not related to the series of rhythmic values they're playing again and again and again. So the cello's got 15 rhythmic values and 5 pitches. So it plays those 5 pitches,
yeah,
3 times, and then it starts the rhythm again. Does that make sense?
So it would be like... something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Mm-hmm. And then you're back to the start of the rhythms.
Okay. So that to me, that doesn't sound too crazy, because 5 goes into mm-hmm. 15.
In the piano part, there are 29 chords to go against the 17 note lengths.
Oh, dear. Wow. That's not going to... repeat anytime soon, is it?
No, the lowest common multiple is 493, which is just 29 times 17. And actually, the piece doesn't even go on that long. It never starts the cycle of pitch and rhythm at the same time.
Okay, I've got loads of questions about this. My first question is, why is that called isorhythm?
Because it's a repeating rhythmic pattern, so the piano plays just that one rhythm.
So the iso only refers to one instrument?
Yes.
At a time. Okay. So the piano player just concentrates on what they're doing and just plays that, and if the piano player were to start to listen to, like, the violin or the cello or the clarinet, they'd be in trouble, because they're not really lining up with the other parts.
The crotchet beat is the same in all of the parts.
Everyone's playing to the same pulse,
mm-hmm.
but if someone is, you know, repeating every 17 beats or whatever, and you're repeating every 13 or 29 or whatever it was, like, trying to understand how your parts are going to line up with other people's is kind of hopeless, because it's not going to line up. That's kind of the point. Is that right?
I think it's not strictly metrical. So the piano's got this repeating rhythm that lasts for 13 beats, but I'm not sure that you're not necessarily feeling that it's in 13 beats in a bar.
Okay.
So the whole thing is written in 3/4.
Okay. Yes. I guess another thought I'm having is the composer wouldn't have planned that on each repeat of, say, the cello's part, the harmony would line up in a really clever way with, say, the piano, so that it all linked all the way along. It's deliberately composed so that it's not going to have these connections with other instruments. Do you know what I mean?
So you mean it's not written so that you've got no.
What I mean is it hasn't been designed so that every, say, 17 beats or whatever, there's a particularly pleasant harmony, because the composer sort of sat down and mathematically wrote parts that would line up in pleasing ways at certain points.
No, yeah.
No, he wasn't trying to do that.
No, not at all. In fact,
the opposite.
I don't think there's a single chord in the whole thing that's just you can label as a major or minor chord.
I can see that. Which would be harder, to write a piece of music where you do get pleasant harmonies arising out of the chaos every 51 repeats or whatever, or to write something that is just chaos all the time?
It depends entirely on the ratios you're using, I think. Like, I think it would be phenomenally hard to use these ratios and get pleasant sounding chords if you've got two isorhythmic parts.
Nice. I've got one more question, and this is probably going to reveal my misunderstanding, but what's the difference between isorhythm and polymeter?
Within a meter, you can have lots of different rhythms. So in 3/4, you can go cha 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 cha, or you go long short long short long. So they're both 3/4, but it's two different rhythms. You can go if we're in 3, 1, 2, 3, da 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 da. So that's a combination of various rhythms, but all within a meter of 3/4.
Yeah.
So in polymeter, you've got two different meters going on, but the rhythms within those meters can be anything that makes sense.
Oh, okay. So isorhythm is a subset of polymeter.
Yes, although it doesn't strictly have to be. The isorhythm doesn't strictly have to be metrical.
Sam, you've got another piece.
So I do have a much earlier example of isorhythm from the 14th century.
Ooh.
And it goes like this.
What is the instrument that's playing?
I'm not actually sure what instrument they're using.
It doesn't sound like a kazoo, but in a way it does sound like a kazoo. Is it like some kind of reeded instrument? What is that?
It could be a double reed instrument.
It just sounds really funny.
Yeah, I'm not sure what instrument it is. I don't have the, like, sleeve note from the recording.
To be honest, I'm not sure. I quite understand isorhythm. I don't see what's different between it and polymeter. I mean, I get what you're saying, that within a meter, you can have different rhythms. And I liked your example of 3-4 and all the different rhythms that you can make with 3-4. But I still don't get the difference between isorhythm and polymeter.
So, this is... Oh, I'm glad I did play this one to you then, because it's a good example. The isorhythmic... There's only one isorhythmic part in this, and it's the tenor line being played by the weird instrument. So most of its notes are fairly long compared to the other ones.
Mm-hmm.
And so it doesn't really have a discernible meter.
What do you mean it doesn't? Because to me, when I was listening to it, it sounded like the weird instrument was starting, it not at random times, but I could hear it at started in relation to what the singers were doing. So I don't know what you mean when you say it's not...
Hold on. What do you mean?
Well, the singers were going... Da, 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 da. It was kind of swung, wasn't it? Most of what the singers were doing. So you'd have your singers going... Bum, 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 bum. Boo. 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 All of those weird instrument impressions that I did then, they all started in relation to the... Like, they weren't always starting on beat one or beat two, but they all...
So it's...
My brain made them line up with something.
So it's... The tenor notes all line up with... I'm trying to put this in because it doesn't work in terms of modern time signatures, this one.
Why not? Because when I listen to it, I hear it in terms of modern time signatures.
So you can just about line up in 6-8.
I heard most of it as a 1, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, 4, a dun, bum, 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 bum. It definitely had a real swing to it, to me.
So it's definitely triple subdivision of
a
beat.
Yeah, like, da, 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 da.
But it's not four beats in a bar.
Okay, okay.
There's no such thing as a bar.
Okay, I don't mind about that. Because the weird instrument, I always heard it as... coming in at a point that was lining up.
Yeah, with... so it's on the beat.
Okay.
But it's not... There are no bars, so there is no four beats in a bar. So it can't have a different number of beats. It can't have a bar made up of a different number of beats.
You see, I don't even read music, but I feel like a bar line is a helpful anchoring point, so you know when you're going to start, like, the chorus, or you know when you're going to start this particular bit, because you count the bars. I find that really conceptually difficult to... I mean, I can imagine a piece of music and you just deleted all the bar lines, but I imagine that's really difficult to read.
It can be quite difficult to read, especially if you're used to reading music with bars. But what they do have, they mark structural points on it. So this isorhythmic part is what gives this piece its structure.
Okay. I've thought of an analogy, not for your benefit, Sam, but maybe for my benefit, maybe for the listeners. It would be like if you were reading text and there were no full stops, or you were reading text and there were no spaces in between the words.
If you go back to your no full stops,
yeah,
aren't some legal documents written with no punctuation?
Are they?
I've got a feeling I've heard that. I may be completely wrong, but it's... Oh, actually, forget that. Something I do know: Latin, classical Latin, doesn't have full stops at the end of a sentence.
Yeah, yeah. Does that make it harder to read?
If you're not used to it, yes, it does, and which is why you can get
translations of Latin that are just really, really long sentences that sound really unwieldy in English.
Sure.
Like translations of liturgical things.
Right. So do you think that that's a fair analogy for this 14th century music? They didn't have bar lines, and that's a bit like not having full stops.
Yes. And actually, if you take it to the Latin example again, it's a good analogy because sentence structure is just different there. And when you translate it, it doesn't sound like normal English.
Okay. So 14th century music didn't have bar lines.
That is correct.
And in that music, the weird instrument is playing the isorhythm.
So it's got 12 rhythmic durations and 18 pitches. So it states the rhythm 3 times and the pitches twice, and then it's back in sync. And then that's a structural unit. That's the end of that section. And then it has a second section that does exactly the same, except it halves all of the rhythms.
Wow. Was this common?
Yes, yeah. It's quite common in 14th century motets.
And what's the purpose of it? Like, does it make it easier for the musicians to perform, or...?
I don't think it makes it easier to perform necessarily, but it's just something that gives the music a structure.
Okay.
So, in the same way that we'll have like a verse-chorus structure, it's just a way to organise the structure of it.
Now, to my mind, I hear what you're saying. You're saying it organises the music into a structure, but it feels like an enormous structure. It sounds like filing all your paperwork in a skyscraper. Sure, it's organised, but it's just vast. Like, when you listen to 14th century music, are you able to think, oh, yep, that's the end of that, I can't remember the word you used, but that chunk, and here we go again for chunk number 2. I know where I am in this piece of music.
So because what they do often is that this second half is half as long, they halve all of the durations.
Okay.
So that you definitely can hear. It's accompanied by other textual changes.
Okay. I feel like the modern system of verse-chorus is a more recognisable structure. Would listeners in the 14th century... You say that there are other textual changes, so that's a clue that we're in a different part of the song now, but would they appreciate the isorhythm? Would they be like, they'd be in the inn drinking do they have flagons of ale? Oh,
I don't know. This is way outside my historical knowledge.
Anyway, let's say they're in the inn and they'd be like, oh, have you heard that latest song and the isorhythm in that is...
again, no, I think they wouldn't necessarily notice, they wouldn't necessarily hear the isorhythm, but they would hear the change from...
The long ones, notes the short one. To halving everything. Okay.
And the structure that it gives as well.
Okay. Nice. Oh, thank you, Sam. Sam, it's time for the third and final piece of mine for you. This is a song called Jambi by Tool. That's quite fun, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't even know. it was great. It was fantastic. But yeah, it's just... I had no innate feeling for any of that. I could feel a beat, but that was about it.
Oh, I'm delighted. Oh, I'm glad. I think I chose the right one out of the ones I could have played you. I listened to that for years without knowing or really thinking about what was going on. Like, I could tell, like, straight away, oh, this is weird. And then, like, one day on the way to work, I just suddenly heard what the bass drum is doing at a particular point. One, two, three, one.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's quite steady, bass drum.
Mm-hmm.
And if you take each of those beats and then divide it into three, you know, one and two and three and that gives you nine beats.
Mm-hmm.
And everything fits into nine. But the trouble is that I think every part is taking those nine beats and adding numbers together to make nine in different ways.
So we talked a little bit about additive meters last time, didn't we?
Yes, I think so. In the Rite of Spring.
Mm-hmm. And in Tricky as well.
Yeah. So once I thought, like, right, okay, there are nine beats here, you can then start to listen to different instruments and work out how are they chopping up those nine beats.
Mm-hmm.
So if we listen to the sort of opening riff. So that's 3 + 2 + 2 + 2. And then everybody's doing that. So the bass guitar is doing that and the drums are doing that as well, which is nice. So you get that for, I think it's about 15 seconds. And then it kind of does the opposite, because instead of 3 + 2 + 2 + 2, it then goes 2 + 2 + 2 + 3. But of course you've got the bass drum just doing 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3, mm-hmm, and accenting the one. It's just all different ways of splitting up nine and having them all play, like, against each other.
Yeah, that's really a really interesting idea, just seeing how many ways you can do it, and it still makes sense as a whole, even if it sounds a bit weird.
Yeah, it's weird. And I think I'm not saying that I think that that's polyrhythm, but I think there is one bit that is polyrhythm in the vocals.
Was that just before you stopped? Just before you stopped.
Yeah,
it
I
the
think
first
there's
time.
Like a 3/2 feel bit.
It's definitely polymeter though.
Polymeter. Okay.
Even though it's all in 9/8 or 9/16, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah. Another thing I just really like about it is that. Sound of the guitar, the at the beginning there. It's like a, I don't know, what is that? I can do that with drumsticks, actually. The
I was meaning to ask you, what's the most complicated or the weirdest polyrhythm that you have played, firstly, and that you can play but maybe haven't put into a performance?
I would say that 3 against 2. I'm not saying that's common for me to play, but it's something that I can play, and I've certainly done songs where definitely that sound is something that, you know, that's definitely happened.
And how did you learn to do that?
Carol of the Bells.
Okay, so composite rhythm then.
Yeah,
you do it by a...
Yeah, dun.
Yeah, so you conceptualize it by kind of adding them up and then fitting it into one metric framework.
I think I do it with Swiss rolls. No, I don't know how I do it.
I imagine now it's quite internalized and your hands can just do it on the cajon.
I think so.
But when you were first learning to do that, did you think of it as in three, and it's 1, 2, and 3, 1, 2, and 3?
Oh, I see. I'm not even sure I know what I was thinking. Probably the example that you just did, 1, 2, and 3, probably that. and the one and the and belong to the two sort of beat pattern.
Yeah.
And the one, two, and three belong to the three beat pattern.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think, yeah, no, I think that's fair to say, actually. That's probably how I did it, whether I realised it or not.
Mm-hmm. But now you've got it internalised and you can, your hands just do it without you having to think of it that way.
I think so, yeah. And your other question was, what's the most complicated polyrhythm I can play, but perhaps have never performed? Because in the last episode, the homework was for you to nail a four against three, and mine was to be able to do five against four.
Have you successfully done five against four?
I'll perform it for you, and you be the judge.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Pretty good.
Your five was a little bit shaky, but it was still pretty consistent. I'm impressed.
Where was my five? Who was it? The little clicky laptop or the that was doing the five?
Your clicky laptop one was doing five.
That really surprises me because of the way that I'm conceptualizing this. Can
really?
I play it again? Yeah. Do you think that my four was stronger?
I thought your four was sounded pretty steady, yeah.
That's remarkable. Wow, okay, let me play it again. Because let me tell you how...
It sounded the other way around that time.
Okay. That the four was a bit shaky. That's really funny. The way that I did that was to go into Audacity and generate a click track at, what would it have been, 100 beats per minute. And that had four clicks. And then generate another click track, which was at 120 beats per minute, and that had five beats. And then I listened to it a lot and tried to play along and found that really hard. So then I started thinking of those like little, would it be a mnemonic? Not quite. A word, a phrase that helps you to...
Yeah, that is a mnemonic.
Mnemonic, like a memory aid. And what I came up with was, I haven't heard the news today, and just thought about which syllables of which words line up with which beats in which hand, and then played that, and it was shaky, and then I tried to make it as unshaky as possible.
So again, you created a composite rhythm.
Yes. Yeah. And I think to play five against four properly, you'd need to be really good with your quintuplets, wouldn't you? Because that's not swing, it's not da-da-da, it's da-da-da. Anyway, go on, let's move on to your pieces.
Okay, so my last thing that I'm going to talk about is canon, specifically mensuration canon.
I beg your pardon?
How did I know you were going to say that?
Oh, I was not going to, but then I thought, I've got to say...
I suspected you might say that.
Mensuration. There's no T in it.
There's no... Well, there is, but there's only one T in it.
Okay, T at the end.
Yeah, I can't tell you how many times I had to convince my computer not to autocorrect that word. So this piece I sent you yesterday, have you had a chance to listen to it?
I listened to it six times, and I could not, I couldn't get it.
It's in four parts.
Yeah.
How do you imagine it's written down for these four singers?
Well, I feel like I'm being led into a trap here. I'm going to say four separate, you know, staves.
Oh, I'm impressed, Alan.
Thank you. A stave with the lines. Four of those and four singers. So surely that's got to be soprano, alto, tenor and bass. Tell me how wrong I am.
There is a stave.
Yes.
I don't think anything else was right. But I did lead you into that. So it's not soprano, alto, tenor, bass, because it, at the time it would have been all male voices. But that doesn't really matter. The interesting thing is that it's one stave and one melodic line written out, and everybody reads from that.
Oh. So people start in different places.
So they all start at the same time.
Oh, no.
But
sing at different tempos. No?
Yes. Yeah, they do. So there's an added complication that in modern music notation, we talk about a quarter note and a half note and a whole note, each one of those being half as long as the one above it.
Yeah.
Divide it into two. But in this notation, each one can be either two or three to the next level, depending on context and the mensuration signature.
Oh, dear.
So a breve can consist of either two or three semibreves, and a semibreve can consist of either two or three minima, and that's dependent on the signature and the context. So there's four parts in this piece, but each of them has a different mensuration.
Wow. The mind boggles. So I guess my usual questions, how do you perform this accurately?
So this is pretty difficult to perform from the original notation. So people performing this kind of music often have it in an edition where it's transcribed in
modern
notation.
Okay.
So what we have is one in imperfect tempus, where the breve consists of two semibreves, and one in perfect tempus, where it's three semibreves to a breve. And the semibreves are the same. So that's equivalent to a 3-2 polymeter.
Sure. Another way to put that would be to say that one person is singing 150% faster than another?
Not quite, because whether a particular breve consists of two or three in the perfect time is dependent on what's around it as well. So it's not, those two aren't exactly identical at different speeds.
Oh, okay. Is it that if you imagined having two cassette players and they're both playing the same tape and you press play simultaneously, but every time one cassette gets to, say, a particular word in the song, you play it 150% faster for just that word, and then it goes back to normal speed.
Yes, yeah, it's kind of like that.
So you're saying that with these breves, is that what they're called? Mm-hmm. Every time there's a breve, it's either split into two or split into three.
Yes.
And that depends on what's come before it.
Yeah, so there's a complicated set of rules of how you read this notation.
Just singing just by itself is quite difficult. Reading music adds another layer of complexity. How were the singers of the time supposed to do all this all at once?
This would have been done from memory, most likely. It wouldn't have been performed by everybody reading. The writing was just a way to learn it.
Okay, so we've dealt with two of the four parts.
Yes. So there is a third part that is, it's in imperfect time as well, so it's the breves consist of two semi-breves. But it's also got a proportion sign that means that breve is half as long as the normal breve. Sorry, that semi-breve is half as long as the normal semi-breve.
Okay.
So compared to the other binary voice, that is just exactly the same at twice the speed.
Okay. And the fourth voice?
The fourth voice?
Do they roll the dice? every time you get to a breathe in the music, roll the dice. If you get a six, then each breathe is worth 1/17 of a gone.
So the notation of it is actually by two proportions that then changes it from imperfect to perfect. I'm not going to go into all of the messy mechanics of how that works theoretically, but the net result is that it does exactly the same as the other triple voice, where there's three semi-breathes to a breathe,
okay,
but at 1/3 the speed.
Okay.
Which means that the ratio of notated semi-breathes between the third and fourth voices we just talked about is a polyrhythm in the ratio 3-2.
This is so complicated. I mean, at least it's just twos and threes.
Yes, there are crazy examples of really weird proportions that I can't even think about, but they're mostly theoretical, about theorists going, how far can we push the boundary of our system of notation that we've developed?
Like with just silly numbers, like silly ratios.
Yes.
Like 7-5.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
I don't think there's any examples of that in practice.
I keep coming back to this, but like asking, how do the performers perform it? But also, how does the listener interpret it? Because say you played a piece with a, you know, ratio of 7-5 or something. Who would know? Like, would you know if a musician like slipped up?
Probably not. No.
No, I don't. I don't think you would be able to detect that. Just
so the proportions in this are quite hard to hear, and it's especially difficult because they're not identical necessarily between the duple and triple voices. But could you hear one voice imitating another slightly later?
Yes. There was one bit in particular where, because I knew it was going to be to do with polyrhythm and stuff, I did detect like a little phrase that then appeared a little later, and it did sound similar, but I guess it was slightly slower.
Hmm. So, yeah, it's difficult to hear the proportions, but you can hear that they're singing. They're singing the same melodic line, but you can hear that at least bits of it are the same.
Mm.
It's really impressive how consonant it sounds.
It's a bit like maybe what I was asking earlier about what was the piece for the end of the world?
The quartet for the end of time.
For the end of time. And I asked how easy would it be to have all these different numbers and line them up so it sounds nice, and you said very difficult. But yes, I agree that piece that you just played us, it does sound quite pleasant.
Yes. I mean, it's slightly easy because it's simpler proportions.
Mm-hmm.
It's all 2-3. But because it's four voices all reading the same thing, it is pretty impressive.
Yeah. I liked what you said as well about how theoretically composers were pushing the notation to the limit. Because to me, I think, yeah, that's what this is. This is just having fun with the mathematics of it and just enjoying it for making it insanely complicated. Yeah. But I always wonder, like, yeah, how much does the listener get out of this? Probably not much. Mm-hmm. Once it gets beyond a certain level of complexity.
So talking about how far can we push this idea, that brings us nicely to Nan Caro, whose music was suggested by a commenter on YouTube. I think it was Tarragonable again.
Yeah, it was. Thank you very much for your comment.
How much do you know about Nan Caro's studies for player piano?
Well, I have come across these. There's a YouTube channel, I believe it was 12 tone, and I think they did a video on Nancaro.
Mm-hmm.
And from what I remember, he wrote music that could only be performed by a player piano, so a machine. And am I right that you would load a special drum into a player piano?
So it's punched paper, a bit like punch cards for early computing.
Oh, right. Okay, so Nancaro would punch the paper, and he was doing it in such a way that things were being done on the piano that couldn't physically be played, like, you know, 37 notes all at once, or I can't remember the details.
Yeah, yeah.
But he just wanted to kind of push the piano to its limits, and like really fast runs that no human being could reproduce, that kind of stuff.
In his series of studies for player piano, he explored all of the things that we've talked about today, but pushed a lot of them to extremes because, as you say, he didn't need people to be able to do it.
Yeah.
Study number 40 is nicknamed the Transcendental Study. Have you heard of that one?
I don't think so.
So, in his series of studies, he has canons like the menstruation canon we've just listened to, where the piano will play the same thing twice at different speeds. And he kept pushing and pushing the ratio of the two voices.
Right.
He started with ridiculous proportions that a human couldn't do.
Right.
And then he thought, that's not quite far enough. I'm going to use irrational numbers.
That not even pieces of paper can do.
Do you want to define irrational numbers for listeners?
Cannot be expressed in the form A divided by B, where A and B are integers. But B is not equal to zero.
And then he pushed it even further and said, I'm bored of irrational numbers. Just plain old irrational numbers. I want transcendental numbers now. So numbers that you can't express as a fractional power of an integer.
So one example of a non-transcendental number would be the square root of 2.
Yes. So
because
it's,
that's expressed as 2 to the power of a half.
Yeah. He uses, in study number 40, a ratio of e to pi.
That's silly.
It is a little bit silly. Do you want to have a listen?
Yes, I would like to hear what that sounds like. Yeah, that's not actually how I expected it to sound. And I'll tell you why. It's because not only is he doing the crazy ratio of the two voices, but the melody, if I'm going to call it that, the melody that he's chosen is bizarre. Quite a lot of it sounds like a telephone ringing because it's just so fast, like alternating between two notes or like two chords very rapidly. And there's lots of glissandos. And, you know, if I was going to do that, do the E to pi thing, I think I would have written a more conventional melody and then done the... Do you know what I mean? Then done the ratio thing.
Because there's so many glissandos, it's difficult to pick out where the second voice even comes in.
Yeah, because as we listened to it, I said after maybe a minute or something, oh, that's enough. Like, because I thought that there were than two voices. But you said no, the second voice hasn't even started.
I mean, it's got some more melodic ideas.
Yeah, I thought that sounded quite Star Warsy. You know when you're a kid and you just get these funny ideas about the world? Like, my wife used to think, when she was really little, she used to think that the Queen went round every night switching on the streetlights. Like, and she doesn't know where she got this idea from, because obviously no one would have told her that. And when I was little, I had this idea that the most beautiful piece of music would be the piece of music that used every note on the piano.
As in every single key, all...
Yeah, that you had to, not necessarily all at once, I don't think I've probably even thought about it as much, I just thought, there must be a piece of music that uses every single note, and that's the best. And to me, it sounds like Nan Caro has thought, yeah, I'm going to use every note on the piano. Okay, so I like what you said, how he thought he'd take it to the limit and just do a ratio that can't even be produced accurately on paper. You can't even produce that accurately on a computer, because you would need to subdivide time into infinitesimally small units.
Yes.
That's the whole point, isn't it, of transcendental or even irrational numbers, that you cannot express them as a ratio, and therefore, if you have something like a piece of paper, you will not be able to divide the paper into the right lengths or the distance between the holes. You'll never be able to get that right, because you can't... That's the whole point, you can't divide it. Why did he want to take it to the limits? Was he just, as artists and scientists do, just exploring what's possible?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think he was just doing what artists do, pushing the boundaries.
How seriously did he take his own piano studies?
I don't know very much about him, but from what I've read, I think he did take it fairly seriously.
I imagine that you would have to... You invest a lot of time.
Yeah.
Because there must be, hundreds or thousands of holes on these rolls of paper.
Yeah.
And you said that was piano study number 40.
Yes.
So he was quite committed to it. So you would have to take it seriously, wouldn't you?
Yes, yeah, I think you would.
How are his efforts regarded in the academic music community?
Generally, he's seen as quite innovative and successful. He's he is held in quite high regard.
Right. Now, this might be really controversial of me to say. I feel like what he's done, and this is based only on that piece that you just played, is he's come up with just this crazy melody, and I kind of hesitate to say that, but yeah, let's call it a melody. And then it's almost like a gimmick, this pi over E. Do you know what I mean? Like, how much value is there in it as a piece of music? Is it, to me, it feels more like an experiment.
Yeah, I think I know what you mean, and it is experimental, but...
He was the first to do it, I guess.
As far as I know, yes.
And actually, that's worth quite a lot, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think, like, his canons like this are... They are still pieces of music. And
sure.
I think they can be enjoyed as pieces of music, as well as it being intellectualized, thinking about what he's actually done.
Okay. To me, it also feels like you would enjoy it more if you knew what was behind it. You'd almost perhaps have this sort of snobbish attitude, like, oh yes, I recognize this. This is Nan Caro. Don't you know that he, you know, used irrational numbers and transcendental numbers to generate this.
Yeah, I mean, there is some kind of debate in the world of classical music as to whether or not it's like 20th and 21st century classical music is elitist.
Right.
In this way.
I want to hurry to say as well, I don't think there's anything wrong with admiring it for those reasons. In fact, I think that that's one of the reasons to admire it. But what would bug me slightly is if someone only appreciated it because of its mathematical novelty.
Mm-hmm. I understand what you're feeling there. Any kind of modernist art can have that sort of effect where if you don't know the background, it's harder to appreciate.
To me, with some of Nankari's music, you have to know what's behind it before you can appreciate it, or just to appreciate it more.
A lot of this kind of music you can still enjoy and appreciate, even if you don't know what he's doing. But I think you're right that knowing that gives you a different kind of appreciation for it. And actually, one interesting thing is that there are quite a lot of people who appreciate this music but don't understand what he's doing, because they have a misconception about what it is.
Oh, what's the misconception?
So the way he kind of notates this in his way of writing down what he's done and how it should be played by the player piano, he'll write this ratio essentially as a fraction e over pi.
Right.
But because we write time signatures as one number over another, a lot of people think it's just a time signature of e pi.
Gotcha. Now, in terms of time signatures, you'd write both parts in 4-4, but you would do a tempo marking on the first piece, which would say something like 120 E BPM. No, 120 E, that would be way too fast. Say it would be like 40 E BPM. And in the other voice, you would write 40 pi BPM.
That's exactly it, yeah.
Yeah,
so,
okay.
So far, all of the other things we've talked about, polyrhythm and polymeter, something has been kept the same. In polyrhythm, your bar lengths are the same,
yeah,
and it's divided differently. In polymeter, your beats are the same, but you draw the bar lines differently. But this is something else entirely. This is polytempo. If you like.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah.
Where nothing lines up. But yeah, a lot of people think it's E pi as a time signature, which would be, well, that doesn't make sense as a time signature.
Maybe, you know, I'm always asking you, like, what the number on the bottom means. Let me just get that again. So in 4-4, the 4 on the top tells you how many beats are in the bar,
mm-hmm.
and the 4 on the bottom tells you kind of the duration of the beat. So it's a quarter note.
Yes.
And so 3-4 means 3 quarter notes. 6-8 means 6/8 notes, or as you would say, 6 quavers.
Mm-hmm. The bottom number tells you what kind of beat you're talking about. So if it's 2-4, you're talking about quarter notes or crotchets. Yeah. And that number always has to be a power of 2, because the way the notation works is that each note is half of the next level up. So you've got quarter notes and eighth notes and 16th notes.
But you could do a third of the note above.
You could do a third of the note above, which we call a triplet. So give me an example time signature with 3 as the second number.
4-3.
Okay, 4-3. So what we're saying is that that's four triplet half notes in a bar. So if it's over three, then it's a third of a whole note.
Yeah.
Which is a triplet half note in our system of notation.
Right.
So how are you dividing that?
I don't know.
Basically, the point I'm getting at is the bottom number
yeah.
is purely about how we write it down on paper.
Right.
So there is no difference between 4-4 and 4-2. It's just about which note values do we write it down with.
Yeah, okay. So what you're saying is the number on the bottom doesn't matter. It just tells you whether a particular note length, boop, should be written as a crotchet or a minim or some other
yeah.
thing.
Okay. That's exactly right. So it's purely notational, and because our system of notation breaks each one down into the next layer by halving it,
yeah,
then it would be pointless to use any other one in the time signature.
Okay.
Because it would be a lot more simple to write using a power of two. So okay. it's only ever powers of two on the bottom.
Yeah.
And then the second thing is that the time signature is an indicator of the top number is the indicator of the meter, how many beats in a bar. And you couldn't have not a whole number of beats in a bar, because if you did, then it's not a meter.
When I did the Pi instrumental song, the number file, many years ago, I did experiment with having a bar that was Pi quarter notes in length. And I didn't include it in the final song because I couldn't get it to sound good. But I could do it mathematically. If a quarter note lasts for, say, 1/4 of a second, keep it simple, then a bar of 4/4 would last for 1 second, and a bar of π/4 would last for approximately 0.75 seconds, mm-hmm. but not quite that, a bit longer.
And how would you divide that bar up into beats?
Well, I'd have three equal beats, bum, bum, bum. And then there'd be like this pause that was just the right length, just a very short pause that would mean it so that the whole bar was pi units long instead of 3 units long. It's non-metrical, Sam.
Exactly. Which means... like,
but it is... But it is measured. When you perform this piece, you must leave that pause to be exactly 0.14159 units of, you know, fraction of a crotchet in length before starting the next bar.
Mm-hmm. Maybe you've convinced me a little bit on that.
I'm excited. So what we've concluded is Nancarrow didn't write in a time signature of pi e, rather that these are the ratio of the tempos.
Exactly.
Ah, brilliant. That's been quite a journey, Sam.
Yeah, our listeners are probably exhausted.
I feel exhausted, but exhilarated at the same time.
Yes, yeah, it was really, really interesting. I feel like I've kind of dominated the discussion, though, with all of my ridiculous proportions.
That's really good. That's a funny, funny thing to say. I feel I've learned a lot, and I hope that the listener, because I'm assuming that there's just going to be one listener by this point, has also learned a lot. Sam, what should we talk about next time?
Oh, I don't know.
What was it we were talking about earlier on?
We went off on quite a tangent on the subject of acquired taste earlier.
Oh, yeah. Should we do acquired taste next time?
Yeah, I am happy to do acquired tastes next time.
So we're going to perhaps find pieces of music that we didn't like when we first heard them, and then we learned to like them, or however yeah. it works.
Or failed to learn to like them.
Do you know what would be really probably impossible is to try and teach the other person how to... here's how to enjoy this horrible music. Now, Sam, I did my 5 against 4. You described it as slightly shaky. You need to do your 4 against 3.
Oh, all right then. How was that?
I thought a little unsure at the beginning, but I think you got into it.
Yeah. Yeah, so I did that in the same way we were talking about earlier, by creating a composite, but not doing it very well.
What was your composite? Was it past the bread and butter?
Oh, I didn't do it with a mnemonic.
Not a mnemonic, sorry, a composite.
I did write it down to learn it.
Sure. And I guess practiced it at a slower tempo.
Yes, yeah.
You did it quite fast just now. I wasn't expecting that. You really went for it.
I wanted to challenge myself. Because once you create a composite, it's easy to do it really slowly. So tapping on a surface, I'm not very good at polyrhythms. I can do 3-2 okay. But there is another way that I think about it. If I'm playing piano and I've got a melodic line in each hand, but it's got a polyrhythm. So in Chopin, I can be playing 3 notes in my left hand and 5 in my right.
Whoa.
By practicing each line, practice each line so well that my hand just does it, and practice the other line so much, and then just set them off at the same time.
Now, are both your hands running on autopilot when you set them off, or is there one hand that you're kind of concentrating on and you just let the other hand, you trust it and it does its thing?
So in that kind of thing, it's usually 3 in the left and 5 in the right. I'm usually focusing on the 5 and letting the 3 just keep going on its own.
Sure. I guess 3 is more common in more songs. Like doing a triplet is
Yeah, you can keep
normal.
A triplet up naturally.
Yeah. Okay.
I think that's the hardest one that I can pull off is a particular Chopin piece that I play 3 against 5. But because it's Chopin, the tempo is pulled around quite a lot. So you can get away with not doing it strict
sure.
in performance.
And on that note, it's good.
Oh dear. No, don't say it, Alan.
It's goodbye from me.
No, we have to do a better sign-off than that. Because I can't take it seriously.
Okay. So, on that note, I will say goodbye.
I will say goodbye by saying, well done for making it all the way to the end.
I don't even want to think about what a menstruation canon would.
You know, I hadn't even
that sounds
that hadn't even occurred to me.